Item number, SCP-110. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. The entrance to SCP-110 is to remain closed off at all times, unless otherwise permitted by O5. The land covering SCP-110, roughly 6 square kilometers, is to be developed into a suburban area that will not attract the attention of the general public. Any movement that SCP-110 might make is to be explained as minute seismic activity. Further complaints are to be ignored. Description: SCP-110 is an entire city that was found buried 0.5 kilometers underneath a large farm in data-expunged New York. Survey teams 2 and 3 concluded that the amount of surface area that the city is buried under covers approximately 6 square kilometers. Numerous items of high interest have been discovered within SCP-110 and will henceforth be labeled as SCP-110-XX. Known history of SCP-110. 11/08/19. A large earthquake occurs in rural New York, far from any city centers. The only casualties were a man and his dog, so no significant media attention was given to the event. 15/05/19. Minor earthquakes continue to occur in SCP-110's general area. The US federal government dispatches a team of geologists to the site to determine the cause. Results come back inconclusive. 16/05/19. SCP Excavation Team 3 is ordered to investigate the site. Upon arrival, the team is greeted by SCP-110-01, who is then detained and moved to Data Expunged for further questioning. 24/05/19. Information gained from SCP-110-01 and SCP reveal that there has been a large temporal disturbance in the area of SCP-110 that has been causing earthquakes due to displacement of soil and rock. Another SCP excavation team is sent to the site. 09/02/2000. After many months of work, SCP excavation teams 4 and 5 are only able to reveal the strong, impenetrable, concrete-like shell of SCP-110. Investigation is halted until further information becomes available. 25/07/2000. Due to the recent decoding and decryption of the files contained on SCP, schematics of SCP-110 have become available. Excavation teams 4 and 5 are sent back on site to locate the primary entrance of SCP-110. 04/08/2000. The entrance to SCP-110 has been discovered, and the excavation teams are immediately met with what can only be described as a foul odor. SCP-110 had been an active Class 4 city, but due to a temporal accident, its core services were heavily damaged, and the entire city was displaced. Work begins to cover up the existence of SCP-110, its excavation, and the thousands of dead civilians inside. Layout of SCP-110. The general layout of SCP-110 is essentially a series of concentric rings connected by tram, train, and other transportation lines. Surveyors have determined that SCP-110 has numerous sections and levels to it, all with specific functions, which shall be described in greater detail here. Core services. The numerous maps found posted in what were high-traffic areas of SCP-110 labeled a central column of assorted utilities as core services. Upon exploration, which was limited due to heavy security restrictions, SCP Exploration Team 1 discovered a myriad of technologies that kept the underground city self-sufficient. Among these technologies were a series of matter reconstitution chambers, a combination reactor that provided energy from both nuclear fusion and geothermal sources, an elaborate water recycling system, and a large waste reconstitution area. The core is surrounded by numerous elevators and emergency stairwells. Numerous areas of the core have been assigned to certain personnel for research. Atrium Colossi. This large, open, domed area surrounds the core, and apparently once held vegetation. The dome itself was a massive display, its composition undetermined, which was used solely to depict a sky as an indication of time of day. Numerous tram lines span at least 3 stories of the atrium, all leading to and from the core. Personnel have described them as looking like spokes in a wheel. Upon discovery, the death toll per area was highest in this area, suggesting that it was a high-traffic part of the city. Commercial Ring. A ring of what used to be small, independently owned shops and chains surrounds the atrium colossi. It is unknown whether or not commercial products were manufactured within the city. However, due to the immense size of the core itself, and the city's apparent self-reliance, it is highly likely that the core possesses a manufacturing area. Habitation Ring A. The styles of living spaces found in this area suggest that its inhabitants were the wealthiest of the city. Numerous documents found throughout the city seem to confirm this assumption as well. Habitation Ring B. This entire ring was inhabited by the middle-class citizens of SCP-110. The area is still being searched for items of interest. To date, SCPs have been recovered from here. Habitation Ring C. This ring was inhabited by the lower-class citizens of SCP-110. It was found in extremely poor condition, and is currently being restored by SCP Maintenance Teams 1 through 12. It is speculated that due to its location furthest from the core, it suffered the most damage from the temporal disturbance. Damage to SCP-110 increases proportionally to distance from the core. Atria Vegis. As so named by numerous maps, these atria were only slightly smaller in area than Atrium Colossi, and provided an estimated 80% of all foodstuffs to the population of SCP-110. These atria were once open-air spaces, and thus suffered a great deal of damage upon arrival at the site, as it is estimated that SCP-110 was displaced at least 300 meters below its original position. Recovery of these atria is revealing advanced plant-growing technology that has useful applications. Atrium Animus. Atrium Animus was responsible for the remaining 20% of foodstuffs. This atrium has at least 20 stories that were once modeled after the natural environments of the animals that were raised there. Each level had a tightly controlled climate and was subdivided so that different species of animals had no contact with one another. Some of the genetic labs attached to Atrium Animus were found intact and are currently being explored by personnel. Atria Recreus. These atria were used for the sole purpose of recreation. They are found between the different habitation rings and typically consist of parks, artificial bodies of water, shopping malls, and other types of civilian recreation. These atria have been suggested for use with SCPs that require an outdoor-like environment, or a temperature and humidity-controlled environment. Conversion plans have been drawn up. SCP Research Ring. This city apparently had its outermost ring devoted to research of safe and Euclid class SCPs, although no documentation within the city is able to confirm this ring's existence. This suggests that SCP-110 was not originally designed by the private sector, and rather was used as cover for SCPs currently unknown. This ring is highly dangerous, as it has suffered the most damage out of all sectors of SCP-110. Thus potentially freeing some of the more dangerous SCPs. Only two members of SCP Exploration Team 3 have survived exploring the ring. Their actions are contained within Document Number 110F. Architectural Styles of SCP-110. SCP-110 has been confirmed to be of human origin, and all materials used in its construction are terrestrial. The architectural styles of SCP-110 seem to vary depending on location. The main styles are listed below. Core Services, Utilitarian, Atrium Colossi, Greco-Roman Revival, applies to all Atria. Commercial Ring, Postmodern. Habitation Ring A, Art Deco. Habitation Ring B, Expressionist. Habitation Ring C, Utilitarian. SCP Research Ring, Too Damaged to Determine. The different architectural styles of SCP-110 create a problem when attempting to ascertain the general era in which it was built. The earliest documents found claim that the city was built in Data Expunged by the Data Expunged group. Document Number 001-A, The Last Note. To those who find this document, my name is Stephen Kolsnick. Rather, my name was Stephen Kolsnick. I will be dead by the time you read this. I was the chief engineer of this city, as well as the director of the Data Expunged program, contained within the outer containment and habitation rings. Due to an accident with an entity known as Data Expunged, the entire city of has been dislocated from its original area of Data Expunged. Nobody here knows where we are. From what I have been able to observe, the outer rings have sustained heavy damage, and their contents are threatening the inhabitants of the inner rings. Though we are surely doomed anyway, as the core has sustained heavy damage. Three of the main life-sustaining services contained within the core are damaged beyond reasonable repair. Any attempts to repair them would take more time than we have left to live. Life support systems will go down soon. I would estimate that they have between 4 to 10 hours of function left. To whoever finds this, contain data expunged as best you can. Do not follow the same mistakes as our containment procedures had. If you do, you shall regret it. End document. List of notable SCPs found within SCP-110. Data expunged. Item number, SCP-121. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. Containment Site 83 has been established outside SCP-121 to house personnel dedicated to the containment of SCP-121. The perimeter of SCP-121 is to remain fenced off from the surrounding area, with guards stationed along the perimeter at all times. Guards are to don local military uniforms and remain heavily armed at all times. Rotation of guards is to occur every 4 hours. The surrounding population is to remain informed that SCP-121 is quarantined due to persisting hazardous material. Warning signs are to be placed 75, 50, and 25 kilometers out along roads leading to SCP-121 to deter trespassers. Civilians who approach the perimeter of SCP-121 are to be reminded of the quarantine and forced to depart. Those who resist are to be detained for questioning. In the event that approaching civilians witness an active instance of SCP-121-1 or 2, Class A amnestics are to be administered. Any meteorological data regarding SCP-121's anomalous effect is to be censored, and SCP-121 has been labeled a no-flight zone to prevent knowledge of SCP-121-1 and 2. Site Task Force Iota-71, Home Wreckers, has been established and permanently assigned to Containment Site 83 in response to the threat of SCP-121-2. They are to escort researchers interested in studying non-hostile instances of SCP-121-2, as well as neutralize any instances that have grown to potentially lethal sizes. In the event of an attempted containment breach, Iota-71 is to assist perimeter guards in the neutralization of the instance of SCP-121-2. Any buildings within SCP-121 that develop into SCP-121-1 are to be recorded and monitored at all times for transition into SCP-121-2. Instances of SCP-121-2 that become innately hostile upon transition are to be neutralized. However, passive instances may continue to dwell within the perimeter of SCP-121 for research purposes until they've grown to a size too dangerous to contain or become hostile, at which point they are to be neutralized. Description: SCP-121 is the region of land occupied by the former town of Colorado. The town was home to roughly 6,800 prior to enactment of current containment protocol and holds roughly 3,000 buildings, both residential and commercial. Clouds above SCP-121 appear incapable of entering an area roughly 12 kilometers in diameter, instead passing around the area. It is speculated this is related to SCP-121's range of effect, but it is not known how at this time. Buildings in SCP-121 will sporadically, no more than one at a time, with 3 weeks minimum between manifestation, detach from any foundations and ascend into the air. At this point, these buildings are identified as SCP-121-1. Instances of SCP-121-1 ascend to a random height of a minimum of 45 meters. Regardless of the previous state of the building, doors and windows become locked, and any potential entryways become barricaded by furniture inside. Forced entry has shown an increased ambient temperature of roughly 35 degrees Celsius and a relative humidity of roughly 65%. But a lack of any further anomalous properties. Instances of SCP-121-1 will cease suspension after a minimum period of 10 weeks, but may remain airborne for no more than 15 weeks afterwards. Instances do not show any abnormal levels of durability, and near total destruction of SCP-121-1 upon impact with the ground is common. After impact, the remains of instances of SCP-1211 will contain an ovoid object, approximately 1.2 meters by 1.2 meters by 2 meters, composed of materials consistent with furniture found inside the home. Examination of mostly intact instances of SCP-1211 show an absence of previous furnishings. The object will begin to locomote on its own accord. At this point, it will be referred to as SCP-1212. SCP-1212 begin to form a conglomerate with nearby materials, including debris from SCP-1211, flora, automobiles, and, on rare occasion, other buildings. SCP-1212 will continue to attract objects until it forms a body of material 9 meters in height, at which point the body will animate and appear to take on levels of sentience. SCP-1212 may, at this point, begin to simulate ingesting other material to continue growing at a considerably slower rate. Ingestion appears to be for the sole purpose of continued growth, as instances have gone prolonged periods of time without material. Certain items have been known to attach to SCP-1212 instantaneously, despite size and the lack of simulated ingestion. Instances of SCP-1212 normally resemble animals, capable of locomotion on land, but have been known to take on humanoid forms, and forms that do not resemble any known animal. They are primarily docile, and normally do not display hostility towards personnel unless provoked. However, SCP-1212 instances have been known to form with innate aggressive and territorial behavior. This behavior has also been observed to develop following the accumulation of certain items, including firearms, bladed weapons, and in one example, the taxidermy head of a bear. SCP-121 came to the attention of the Foundation when local authorities were flooded with reports of a previously abandoned residence suddenly flying in the sky. The town was evacuated under the guise of a hazardous material spill, and the residence was observed. Once the instance of SCP-1211 transitioned into SCP-1212, SCP-1212 was quickly neutralized. Following the neutralization, another instance of SCP-1211 developed, and the town was permanently evacuated and contained. This is the only occasion on which the creation of SCP-1211 has so closely followed the creation of an instance of SCP-1212. Incident 121A. On 11/04/98, a sound, described as a muffled siren, was heard for approximately 5 minutes. An active instance of SCP-1211 was suddenly subject to an immense force following the sound, causing the building to prematurely break apart while suspended, before the 10-week minimum. Neighboring towns reported hearing the sound. Local press were informed quarantine staff were being evacuated due to a temporary elevation in toxic levels. The cause of the sound is currently unknown. Further research is recommended. 3 weeks following the sound and the destruction of SCP-1211, the remains finally fell to the ground. Inside the rubble were remnants of the ovoid object found in SCP-1212, along with traces of aluminum slag. Incident 121B. On 05/09/12, a 1991 Dodge Caravan was found suspended 53 meters in the air. Internal surveillance is at this time impossible due to the windows being obscured by what appears to be wool cloth. Further observation of the vehicle is recommended. Item number, SCP-277. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. Due to the difficulties inherent in containing SCP-277, it has been placed under a level lockdown. Activities of the residents of SCP-277 must be monitored by no less than embedded agents, and civilians are not to be aware of Foundation presence or influence. Any attempts to contact civilians within SCP-277 by those outside SCP-277 must be investigated. Personnel must undergo psychological screening before being assigned to SCP-277. Description: SCP-277 is a moderately populated town in The principal anomaly within SCP-277 are apparitions found throughout the area that seem to be images projected from children's thoughts or imagination. These are collectively referred to as SCP-2771. Incidents of SCP-2771 appear as figures, drawn in white outlines, with no physical substantiality of their own. The size, style in which they are drawn, and the complexity of the projections vary from child to child. Prepubescent children are the only individuals capable of producing such incidents, and the process of projecting one seems for the most part to be unconscious and involuntary. An average of incidents of SCP-2771 are present at any given time within the area. While embedded agents are requested to report potentially uncategorized children to their supervisors to be examined, due to the size of SCP-277, the prepubescent population there within, and security complications, this is recognized as occasionally unfeasible. Incidences of SCP-2771 are capable of interacting with each other, although physical objects pass through, leaving no damage to either party. Children frequently play with their projections, and the existence of SCP-2771 is regarded as normal by residents of the town. Civilians in SCP-277 claim that the projections have been present within the town since its colonization. This claim is dubious at best, as there are no records of the area's existence before the year 2000, and the towns immediately surrounding the area deny any knowledge of the city. Testing of members within SCP-277 revealed that their dental, fingerprint, and DNA records correspond with no recorded population databases. When under questioning, civilians denied having memories of living or traveling anywhere but within SCP-277. Operation 277. Update the first. Attempt number to evacuate SCP-277 has commenced on 6:15. Small changes were made to the previously detailed methods of evacuation, namely, expunged, in hopes of avoiding what may have caused previous failures. Residents continue to deny any memory of previous evacuation attempts. Personnel members involved in previous assignments involving the suppression of SCP-2771 and SCP-2771-R in particular seem to have been expunged. More trained personnel and Class D subjects are requested, along with the necessary medical equipment, in the event of another such incident. Operation 277. Update the second. As of 6:23, Operation 277 has proven unsuccessful due to data corrupted. SCP-2771-R demonstrated the ability to render mental damage not only to prepubescents, but to physically mature agents. No further evacuation attempts are to be carried out. Level lockdown suggested. Dr. R. Foundation personnel have been unable to trace the source of file Operation 277. Foundation databanks have been unable to produce an unexpunged copy of the file. No personnel or civilians in the area are able to recall any attempts made to evacuate, and the legitimacy of the file has been called into question multiple times. As per common consensus, however, no further evacuation efforts have been planned. Furthermore, it has been discovered that when a resident of SCP-277 leaves the area for several minutes, they are violently data expunged, and then may be found within the area, with no memory of departing from the area. Addendum 277A. As of 9:14, an unaccounted-for SCP-2771 was photographed in the local library by a Foundation agent. No one in the vicinity claimed to be responsible for the projection. As the appearance and actions of incidents of SCP-2771 are often telling of a child's psychological profile, efforts are being taken to identify the owner of these projections, designated SCP-2771-R. Projections that match the image shown in drawing style or behavior are to be reported immediately. Addendum 277B. Sightings of projections that are similar to SCP-277-R have tripled in frequency since 9:23. On 10:05, there were several child casualties made by members of SCP-277-R upon children's projections. Interview 277A. Interviewed: Agent Davis. Interviewer: Dr. A. Begin log. Dr. A. Right then. Please begin at the point where you first saw the SCP-277... Agent Davis. Well, I was walking to a local diner after the end of my shift when I saw a cluster of them across the street. Dr. A, it would be helpful if you could include as many details as you can recall, Davis. Agent Davis, they were in the form of, rabbits. Most of those are, for some reason. Regular kids imagine things from spaceships to magic beanstalks within an hour, but all I've seen drawn in that style are rabbits. They were huddled at a street intersection, watching the passing people and cars, I think. They don't move very much or play like the other sketches. That's what the personnel there have taken to calling them, sketches. Mostly they watch others. Dr. A, you weren't alarmed by them. Agent Davis. What? No. No, they were pretty common by then. They didn't really do anything hostile, so the hype about them had calmed down. Dr. A, noted. Please continue. Agent Davis. Right. Well, after I walked by them, I heard this kid scream from behind me. Little girl, maybe 8 years old. She'd been playing with her sketch when I passed. This winged pony thing. So I turn around and one of the rabbits is on her sketch. I've never seen anything moving that fast, and it was the closest thing I can think of is consuming it, while the girl was going into some type of seizure. I had trouble making sense of what I was seeing at first. It looked like one huge white scribble in the air. There was no helping the girl. I was holding her so she wouldn't hurt her head against the concrete, but I'm no doctor. More of the rabbits had reached other sketches by then, and those sketches too were being torn apart, and the kids were all screaming. And according to the documents I've been given, this was happening all over the town, right? Dr. A, that's correct. Agent Davis, I unloaded a load of shots into the thing, but of course that didn't help. Don't really know why I did that. They're all in comas now, aren't they? The kids? Dr. A, yes, they are. I think that will be all, Agent Davis. Agent Davis, one last thing. Dr. A, yes? Agent Davis, may I request to be transferred out of SCP-277? Dr. A, you have already been reassigned to SCP... Agent Davis, thanks. Goodbye then, Doctor. End log. Update. 3 months following this incident, members of SCP-277-R have vanished from the area. It is still unknown whether they were projections from a child or a manifestation native to SCP-277 itself. Addendum 277C. Inquiries made to civilians regarding the incident on 10-5 have returned with mixed results. A number of the residents claimed that they had never witnessed such an occurrence before and expressed desire for Foundation officials to quickly identify and prosecute the perpetrator. Others claim that similar events happen periodically, every years. Personnel staffing SCP-277 have expressed discomfort when dealing with members of the town. They smile too wide, as if this entire place is just a fairy tale, and that massacre was just part of their happy ending. Agent J. Item number, SCP-333. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-333-A1 through 1618 are to be stored in a standard secure containment locker within sight, accessible only by personnel possessing level 3 clearance or greater, with authorization of at least 2 clearance level 4 personnel. As testing with SCP-333-B and SCP-333-C has concluded, any performance of SCP-333-A is strictly prohibited. Description. SCP-333-A are 1,618 identical copies of a musical score of unknown title and origin. When the score denoted by SCP-333-A is performed by an orchestra of sufficient size, SCP-333-B manifests. The chamber SCP-333-A is performed in may be entered normally. However, roughly 3 minutes into a performance, anything leaving the chamber arrives in SCP-333-B. Re-entry of the performance hall from SCP-333-B is possible, given it is temporarily integrated into SCP-333-B. SCP-333-B appears to be a metropolitan area, devoid of any signs of habitation, past or present. Due to its nature, it is unknown when SCP-333-B was constructed, using what materials, by whom, or even if it was constructed in the conventional sense at all. For as long as performance of SCP-333-A continues, SCP-333-B may be traversed. Following cessation of a performance, SCP-333-B dematerializes, along with anything within at the time. Instrumentation left within suggests that unless a performance of SCP-333-A is occurring, SCP-333-B experiences no passage of time and may not exist at all. SCP-333-C is a highly aggressive entity of variable appearance and composition, residing within SCP-333-B. All manifestations of SCP-333-C have proven much more durable than its composition would suggest, requiring considerable firepower to terminate outside of SCP-333-B, and possessing apparent invincibility while within. Should SCP-333-C manage to escape SCP-333-B, it will remain until the next time SCP-333-B manifests unless terminated. Following termination, SCP-333-C will dematerialize as well. Addendum 333-1. SCP-333-B will not fully manifest unless SCP-333-A is performed by a minimum of 49 musicians within a single concert hall. Larger numbers of musicians appear to correlate to a larger and more complex metropolitan area. Additionally, simultaneous performances in differing locales result in integration of all concert halls within which SCP-333-A is being performed. SCP-333-B could hypothetically serve as a means of rapid transit between Foundation facilities. Addendum 333-2. The content of all 1,618 original instances of SCP-333-A have been observed to change following each performance. All remain identical to each other. Copies of SCP-333-A do not display this polymorphic nature. Addendum 333-3. Changes undergone by SCP-333-A appear to constitute the inclusion of motifs, representing any foreign materials left behind by exploration teams. Given that copies of original SCP-333-A do not update to reflect material within SCP-333-B, it may be possible to selectively manifest materials, and possibly even personnel, within SCP-333-B. A more in-depth cost-benefit analysis will follow. Addendum 333-4. Visual, chemical, and mass spectrometric examination of structures within SCP-333-B indicates their composition is directly dependent upon the composition of instrumentation utilized for the corresponding performance of SCP-333-A. Additionally, it appears that the better a particular instrument is played, the less its composition is reflected within SCP-333-B. Given that structures within SCP-333-B are always of similar composition to the instruments utilized, it has been suggested that these structures may not have a finite composition. However, considering errors cause the composition of a particular instrument to feature more prominently, it is also possible that corruption of SCP-333-B is unavoidable due to general inability to perform SCP-333-A precisely enough. Experiment logs SCP-333-AB 1-9 are pending declassification. Addendum 333-5. Cost-benefit analysis regarding SCP-333 as a Foundation asset. Rapid long-distance transit. If used for transit between facilities, SCP-333-B could allow for rapid dissemination of SCP objects in the event of a containment breach. This risk should not be taken lightly. Cloning of personnel, items, SCP objects, etc., effectively granting the Foundation access to infinite resources. A contingency plan in case of or class events. Personnel critical to the operation of the Foundation, a cache of useful SCP objects, and a store of various provisions and resources could be left within SCP-333-B. This would ensure their survival, provided performance of a suitable copy of SCP-333-A may take place. A garrison and armory. The song itself could be utilized as several different Foundation facilities simultaneously. Particularly dangerous Euclid and Keter objects could each be deposited in their own instance of SCP-333-B. If SCP-333-A is performed as it was prior to an SCP object being deposited, SCP-333-B will manifest without the SCP. If SCP-333-A is performed as it is following an SCP object being deposited, SCP-333-B will manifest with the SCP present. Performances of identical copies of SCP-333-A could take place in several locations, allowing access to the prospective facility from several places. A kill switch to sever SCP-333-B from any adjoining facilities is strongly advised. The risk of accidental discovery of the SCP-333-A should be carefully considered before any utilization of the SCP-333-B for these purposes takes place. Note: the contents of Addendum 333-5 have been struck through. Consult Addendum 333-9. Addendum 333-6. SCP-333-C is capable of leaving SCP-333-B. Any sighting of SCP-333-C within SCP-333-B is grounds for immediate evacuation and cessation of SCP-333-A performance. Addendum 333-7. Composition of SCP-333-C appears linked to musical instruments utilized in similar fashion to 333-B. Closer scrutiny of footage recorded during experiments SCP-333-AB1, 2, 3, 5, and 8 has found SCP-333-C present, appearing to be of similar composition to each corresponding instance of SCP-333-B, making it difficult to distinguish from its surroundings. This likely explains why its presence initially went unnoticed. Addendum 333-8. Operation unsuccessful. Operation losses exceeded 90%. A 5 megaton tactical nuclear device was detonated within SCP-333-B in a last-ditch attempt to prevent SCP-333-C escaping. SCP-333-C was undeterred. Addendum 333-9. Corruption of materials left within 333-B has been noted. This corruption generally takes the form of minuscule changes in chemical composition of objects left within, though in extreme cases, physical deformation has been observed. Notable examples include malfunction of ROV-13-B due to critical circuitry being displaced by and the discovery of D-17711's skeletal system being composed of 0.1% brass by weight. I hereby rescind my prior recommendations for utilization of SCP-333. Dr. N. Addendum 333-10. Computer-aided analysis of SCP-333-A and all copies thereof, considered alongside the events of experiment SCP-333-AB1-9 and Operation indicates beyond a shadow of a doubt that SCP-333-A dictates any and all occurrences within SCP-333-B, including activity of Foundation personnel and SCP-333-C. All further testing of SCP-333 is hereby suspended indefinitely. Item number SCP-419. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-419 is to be kept within a steel alloy frame and attached to its accommodating wall space. No covering or casing is present. SCP-419 currently resides in a room inside Site 33. Dimensions 3 meters by 5 meters by 4 meters. All of the walls in the containment unit, including the one behind SCP-419, are made of a mesh of plastic, steel, and concrete. On the north-facing wall of the containment room is a viewing bay. Note that there is no physical barrier between the viewing bay and SCP-419. Leading to another room with the same dimensions. Two guards are positioned outside of the containment room near the viewing bay and are authorized to use lethal force. They shift every 3 hours. SCP-419 must be cleaned daily with ordinary window cleaning supplies. Any personnel tasked with maintenance must not suffer from acrophobia. Constant monitoring of SCP-419 must take place from the viewing bay in order to ensure that the view through SCP-419 does not change significantly. In the event that it does, contact Site Director. Access to SCP-419 is prohibited, except under special conditions and permission from Site Director. Description: SCP-419 is a large pane of reinforced glass, 1.5 meters by 3.6 meters by 7.6 centimeters in dimensions. One side of SCP-419 does not allow light to pass through. Instead, it displays a view of what appears to be an extra-dimensional urban environment. This phenomenon is only present when viewed directly by a human subject. Photographs, motion sensors, and vision-enhancing objects such as glasses or contacts all act on SCP-419 as if it were a mirror. The scene viewed through SCP-419 appears to be outside, but lacks any natural lighting, regardless of the time it is viewed. No superterrestrial forms, such as celestial bodies, are visible. The view would appear to originate from a vantage point high above ground level. Approximately 800 lux of light emanates from SCP-419, despite the lack of a light source. The source of this phenomenon is theorized to be whatever environment SCP-419 displays. Light from SCP-419's testing chamber does not affect this scene. The buildings visible through SCP-419 appear similar to those of the Victorian architectural period. However, they tend to have unusual, almost imperceptible changes that make them appear warped or twisted or occupying spaces they should not. Much, if not all, of the area viewed through SCP-419 is non-Euclidean. Estimates of the size of this city vary depending on when it is viewed and have ranged from approximately 12 square kilometers to over 60. A multitude of neon lights and signs have been noted, but are not in any known language. Organisms have been viewed walking, albeit only en masse due to their relatively small size. Their actual size is currently unknown due to the lack of a scale. They appear to be humanoid and dark red in color. However, the lack of available computerized assistance and the obvious flaws in the human eye does not allow for a higher level of detail to be ascertained. Due to their seemingly advanced level of technology, the running theory among researchers is that this is not their actual skin color, but rather their clothing. Additional description: prior to Incident 419B, obsolete. Occasionally, large metallic constructs have been viewed moving through the streets, followed by large masses of the humanoids. During these occasions, such processions compose all of the visible movement within the city. Dr. notes that these processions are highly reminiscent of military marches, due to their extremely geometric nature and constant pace. After Incident 419B. Following Incident 419B, the entire landscape viewed through SCP-419 has changed drastically. Many of the buildings appear to be lit on fire or smoldering. Much of the ground is covered in rubble, and there is almost no visible movement from the previously described red humanoids. However, what appear to be similarly shaped dark blue humanoids have been observed performing similar processions. Approximately 1% of the buildings consistently observed before Incident 419B have collapsed. Visibility has also been significantly obscured by an opaque gas, theorized to be smoke. Upon closer inspection, a multitude of dark gray figures are visible in the streets, but remain stationary. The implications of this event are unknown. Note 92713. SCP-419 seems to be aging at an abnormally fast rate. We currently believe this is due to the atmosphere on the other side, though we obviously cannot test it to know for sure. At this speed, SCP-419 could become non-functional as soon as 2019. What this will mean, we do not yet know. Colson.
Item number: SCP-468. Object class: Euclid. Special containment procedures: A buffer area of 1 kilometer is to be maintained around SCP-468-2. Individuals found inside upon initial Foundation acquisition may only exit with the permission of the overseeing Level 4 researcher. All Foundation personnel entering for purposes of observation must exit 2 hours after entrance. SCP-468-1 is not to be moved from SCP-468-2. It is to be contained within a standard locked containment unit. One video camera inside the unit is to monitor SCP-468-1's movement. The unlocking combination is held by the overseeing Level 4 researcher. Description: SCP-468-1 is an abacus with dimensions of 20 by 7 centimeters, in near perfect condition, with no missing beads or signs of disrepair. Its beads, despite the lack of any obvious motor or driving system, will move autonomously. Periods of movement are interspersed by periods of rest, which usually last 3 to 5 hours. SCP-468-1's beads will often perform basic arithmetic operations, though this is not always the case. SCP-468-2 is the former farming village of located in the Chinese province of Jiangsu, with an area of about 2.3 square kilometers. It is presumed that the previous owner of SCP-468-1 lived within this village. Research Site 133, which houses all personnel assigned to SCP-468, is located 3 kilometers from SCP-468-2. Foundation investigations have data expunged. Roads, houses, and other sufficiently large man-made structures inside SCP-468-2 will shift their positions as SCP-468-1 itself moves. Movement invariably results in the formation of geometric patterns. Usually, roads lined with houses will move to form rows and columns. Other patterns that have been observed include basic circular and triangular patterns. Researchers have recorded a relation between arithmetical operations done by SCP-468-1 and the movement of SCP-468-2. For example, SCP-468-1 moving to multiply 10 and 32 resulted in a 10 by 32 grid pattern, with outlying houses forming a perimeter around the resultant grid. All sufficiently large animals, including horses, dogs, cats, and human beings, within SCP-468-2 are subject to its effects. During periods of SCP-468-1's rest, affected subjects will travel between structures. Only SCP-468-2's roads will be used to travel. No two subjects will ever travel in different directions on the same road. The speed of travel is invariably 2.3 meters per second, with one pace taken every 0.6 seconds. Mathematical functions are often performed with affected subjects acting as counters. Animals susceptible to SCP-468-2's effects begin to display symptoms 2.5 hours after entry into the village. The initial symptom is the loss of all complex mental functions, such as basic coordination, language skills, and reasoning. After 3 hours inside, instinctive and reflexive actions, such as the fight-or-flight response, are forgotten. After 3.5 hours, brain activity reduces to an essentially comatose state, and only the knowledge of how to walk is retained. However, only a certain number of affected individuals actually take place in group movement at any given time. Because of this, surplus beings will simply data expunged. If enough subjects are removed from SCP-468-2 such that the number of affected individuals inside is less than all movement will cease. It can only resume once members of the same species as the removed subjects are placed inside SCP-468-2. Despite their inability to consume food or water, all subjects seem to be in perfect health. Removing SCP-468-1 from SCP-468-2 causes all activity within SCP-468-2 to cease, though affected subjects do not regain lost mental capacity. Given the research opportunity that would be lost, this is prohibited. Addendum 468A. Before it became the focus of Foundation attention, SCP-468-2 was a relatively isolated community. Beginning January 12th, 19, residents reported roads and houses shifting several meters in sudden bursts. Local authorities assumed tectonic instability to be the cause of the moving structures and advised all residents to evacuate. Approximately half of the population complied. By February 3rd, no more reports were filed concerning the believed tectonic instability. By March 21st, attempts to contact people living in the village were met with no response, prompting Foundation involvement. By the time nearby agents arrived, the entire remaining population had succumbed to SCP-4682's effects. A discrepancy exists between the population of SCP-4682 post-earthquake evacuation, 188, and the current human population, 66. Extensive Foundation exploration has not found a single member of the missing 122. Data expunged. Addendum 468B. Patterns and calculations made by SCP-4682 have begun increasing in complexity since observation has begun. While only basic addition and subtraction were seen when first discovered, its repertoire of mathematical operations has expanded to include multiplication and division, calculating the area of quadrilaterals, triangles, and circles, comparing proportions, and finding the square roots of two-digit numbers. On July 19th, 2000, SCP-4682 arranged in grid patterns used for basic arithmetic. However, Foundation observers quickly realized that the right half of SCP-4682 had only very limited activity, whereas the left side exhibited an abnormal increase in subject movement. Dr. F, upon investigating the matter, theorized that the computations being made were an attempt to perform matrix multiplication, with the left-hand side acting as scratch work, and the right-hand side including the actual matrices. After only 39 minutes, all subject movement ceased, and SCP-4681 entered another period of movement, the shortest recorded period of rest yet. Researcher estimates place the time required for matrix multiplication to take place inside SCP-4682 at approximately 3 days. Matrix multiplication was an unusual jump in the normally steady progression of mathematical complexity previously undergone. Furthermore, the subsequent arrangement of SCP-4682 facilitated fraction multiplication, the only recorded instance of a decrease in mathematical complexity between rearrangement periods.
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.